Welcome to part 10 of our series of Sprinkling of the Ashes of Red Haifa. Alright, we were reading Yirmeyahu chapter 31 about Ephraim lamenting and saying that he was like an unaccustomed to yoke, like a calf. Now there's a different word used for calf over here, unlike which we saw para, right, which means also a cow, bull or a heifer. Here, agal is used, okay? Now, this agal is from the same as H5696, a male calf, especially one nearly grown, that is a steer, bullock or a calf, okay? So, this word is used to describe the turning back of Ephraim towards Yahuwah. So, the agal shows the end turning around. Gal means to turn, all right? Gal means to turn or round, something that is round, okay, like a skull, like gal means skull because your head is round, okay, and that's the reason Galgalat, that is Golgotha, was the place where Yahushua Mashiach was impaled, okay, and that was known as the place of the skull because it is round, okay. So Ephraim, like a nearly grown calf who is unaccustomed to yoke, is turning back to Yahuwah. What a beautiful picture. That's the reason Yahuwah uses the word agal over here. Okay. And we've already seen about kanaf, the root word af, which we saw in H1610, which means extension of the body and shows Mashiach coming in the body of the flesh to heal the lost sheep of the house of Yasharel. By his wounds, he came as a suffering servant and died outside the camp. Ephraim was like a calf, unaccustomed to yoke, but he turns back to be yoked with Mashiach. Alright, the parable of the prodigal son is the lost sheep of the house of Yasharel returning, right, which is turn and return, shub bashub, to the father's house for whom the fattened calf was killed. The fattened calf was agal. Okay, Luke chapter 15 verses 30, but when this your son came who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. His elder brother is complaining that, you know, you killed the fattened calf for him. So Ephraim the son repents. He was chastised as a bullock, unaccustomed to the yoke. Ephraim is like to an unyoked calf, agal. This reveals the connection with the red heifer. A sacrifice was needed to restore the relationship between Yahuwah and Ephraim. And like I said, the red heifer, all right, was a full grown cow or a bull. And agal was a nearly grown, you know, cow or a calf. That's the reason it's called a calf. Okay. And by Ephraim, all right, turning back to Yahuwah, all right, to be yoked with him in a renewed covenant, all right, he turns to the red heifer. He becomes a full grown, you know, red heifer for whom in whose place Yahushua HaMashiach was impaled. What a beautiful picture of the redemption plan of Yahuwah. All right, where we had to go to the gallows for to be killed, because the death penalty, we were holding the death penalty on us, we were holding the waters of jealousy you know, for us, but he redeems us as the Adam Para. What a beautiful covenant, what a beautiful Yahuwah we have, who's become our Yahusha. All right, so so indeed the house of Yasharel will then be deemed a virgin when she repents. She returns to a clean state when she has been cleansed from a condition of Nidda. Nidda means uncleanliness. It is then that she can become the bride. So Yahuwah would do this through a renewed covenant. This is exactly what Ephraim needed. Because of the calf of the house of Yasharel, he was outside the camp. He needed purification and restoration with Yahuwah. He needed to be cleansed from the taint of death, sprinkled with waters of purification from the sacrifice of the fruitful man, Yahusha HaMashiach, who is the fulfillment of Adam Para. So for the golden calf, he was cast out of the camp and he comes back through the Adampara. What a beautiful picture. Amazing indeed, the love of Yahuwah. Right, and we will read Ezekiel chapter 36 and verses 22 onwards. It says, "Therefore say to the house of Yasharel, thus said the Master Yahuwah, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Yasharel, but for my set apart name's sake, which you have profaned among the Gentiles wherever you went, and I shall set apart my great name, which has been profaned among the Gentiles, which you have profaned in their midst. And the Gentiles shall know that I am Yahuwah, declares the Master Yahuwah, when I am set apart in you before their eyes. And I shall take you from among the Gentiles, and I shall gather you out of all lands, and I shall bring you into your own land. Verse 25, and I shall sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I cleanse you, and I shall give you a new heart and put a new ruach within you, and I shall take the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I shall give you a heart of and I shall take the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I shall give you a heart of flesh, and put my ruach within you, and I shall cause you to walk in my laws and guard my right rulings and shall do them." All right, hallelujah, Yahuwah. So it's all because of our Adampara. There is one more thing I would like to just quickly share about, okay, and that was in Psalms chapter 24, when we read verses 7 to 10, it says, "Lift up the gates' heads and be lifted up doors everlasting, and he will come, King of esteem." Who is this King of esteem? Yahuwah strong and mighty, Yahuwah mighty in battle. "Lift up gates' heads and lift up doors everlasting, and he will come, King of esteem." Who is this King of esteem? Yahuwah of hosts, he is the King of esteem. Selah. So we saw about the three gates, all right? The three gates, that is Susa gate, the Hulda gate, and the Tadi gate, from where the worshippers used to enter in. And there was a Soreg fence. This Soreg fence was broken down. The middle wall of partition is broken down. And now the worshipper can go into the set apart place. And that's what it says, open everlasting doors. Let the King of esteem come in. Who is this King of esteem? Yahuwah, mighty in battle. And doesn't it say that Yahusha spoiled the principalities and powers and made a public spectacle of them? He is Yahuwah, all right, who is mighty in battle. And he broke down the middle wall of partition, making both the Yehudite as well as the Gentile one in him. The Gentiles are the lost sheep of the house of Yasharel. The other last thing I want to touch upon is the doors of the most set apart place. All right, you can read this in my note, which is on my timeline, the everlasting gates and doors opened. So I won't cover it in detail because we are running out of time and this is the last part. So if you read in 1 Kings chapter 6 verses 31 to 32, all right, it tells when Shlomo made the doors of the set apart place, okay, the entrance for the oracle, which is the most set apart place, okay, he made doors of olive wood, the lintel, the side posts, which the word Hebrew word is mazuzot. He made five. So now many people get confused thinking that he made five doors. No, it talks about the side posts, which were five. If you count your five side posts, okay, that's what I have mentioned. And this is how ancient doors used to be with the side post. This is of a door which is made of stone, but this was made of olive wood, okay, doors of olive wood. And the outer door to the set apart place had four side posts, and the doors were made of cypress wood. This you can read in 1 Kings chapter 6 verses 33 and verses 34, okay. So we won't get into that, but I would like to highlight this 4 plus 5 side posts which cling to the walls of the set apart place. So number 9, 5 plus 4 is 9. Number 9 has a significance because number 9, the word Tasha, H8672, two, all right, is as through the idea of a turn to the next of full number 10. So number 9 points out to number 10, saying that you are just about to be completed. You are just about to reach a completeness, to a wholeness. So also this set apart place, the most set apart place, which stood with these side posts clinging to them, you know, shows us, points out to us, to our completeness in Mashiach. There was a need for completeness in Mashiach. All right, because here through this door, the most set apart place, only the Kahan HaGadol, the high priest, could enter on the day of Yom Kippur, just one day in an entire year. That also for his own sins and for the sins of the people of Yasharel. But here, we are called to enter into the most set apart place, not this place, not the physical place. This stood as a shadow, and these side posts point out, the 9 side posts, 5 plus 4, point out to an idea of a need for a completeness. All right, the most set apart place, which is the Hashamayim himself, where the throne of Yahuwah is, where we will enter, and we have already entered in the Ruach through the veil of the flesh of HaMashiach. Such a wonderful Mashiach we have, right, who has you know, come down and taken upon himself our judgment, and he has given us a hope of completeness. The scripture says that we are complete in him. Alleluia, we are complete in him. Okay, so I just encourage you to read this note in detail. I have also mentioned about the Soreg and, you know, everything that we discussed in this study, but I couldn't cover everything because this study has already become so lengthy. Okay, so Shalom, family. My prayer is that each and every one of you understand the mysteries of the HaShamayim. We are very close at the coming of the HaMashiach, because these things which are concealed in his Dabar have been opened up to us to understand that, you know, the King of Esteem, who is Yahuwah, he is come through those everlasting doors and made us one in Ruach with him, because that's what the scripture says, that he who is joined to the Adon, that is HaMashiach, is one Ruach with him. So my prayer is that you understand these deep hidden mysteries, and please do give feedback or anything that you would like to share on the comment section in my videos. Shalom.